She went back there, local Paul.
Yes, the garbage. Sorry about that, that was kind of one of those, I had just recently done it, but then you wanted the pools and.
No, it was in Ohio, but it was kind of ironic, it was 72. Ohio had amazing blue bison. I thought that was kind of funny. You know, and Michigan did it to honor all the colleges back in the 60s. And all the college colleges. Actually, Michigan did it in 67. Here they did it. And I think in 72, Green's white. White. Eastern Michigan, Michigan State. But we got to do our other stuff. We had some interesting things, they had some old Tonka trucks. Yeah, there was the same box variety. Oh, they had some interesting signs and things like that. Created that Coney Island kind of bar.
Thank you. street, people in their mouth.
And she wants her daddy. See?
Well, fine.
Thank you.
Please join me for our opening prayer found in your bulletins. Lord, I thank you that in the great labyrinth of life, you do not wait for my consent to lead me. I thank you that you lead me by a way I do not know, by a way that is above the level of my poor understanding. Do not ask me where I would like to go. Tell me where to go. Lead me in your own way. Hold me in your own light. Amen. Church this Sunday. We're thankful for all of you who are here, especially we have a number of visitors here for the baptism we're going to have in a little bit. We welcome you. We're glad that you could join us today. In the back of your bulletin, we have a few other announcements. Oh, and also let me welcome everyone who's online too. We're glad that you're here with us today. Leave a comment so we know that you're here, and any prayer requests, and we'll pray for them as well. After the service today, the trustees have their monthly meeting downstairs. Again, when the service ends, we encourage you to socialize outside as opposed to inside. We have another baptism next Sunday. We have several baptisms this summer, and that is Lorena Shaw will be baptized next Sunday, and we'll also have a communion next Sunday, too. And in 2 weeks, we'll have our quarterly business meeting. That is July 12th, and we'll meet here in the sanctuary after the service on July 12th. If you haven't already, new directories for the church are out. They're on the back in the foyer on the info table. If you'd like, feel free to pick one up. And we have, we're helping Alpha Omega. That is the Women's Pregnancy Crisis Center in Hillsdale. They are doing a fundraiser called their Baby Bottle Drive. And on the back table is the basket with the bottles, and they ask you to take one over the next month or so just to put your spare change in it, and then you can bring it back to the church and we'll give it to them. They do a lot of good work for obviously unplanned pregnancies, but also helping those who are in need of material possessions like diapers and formula, and also grief counseling for those who had abortions or had miscarriages. So they do a lot of good work for both women and men as well in Hillsdale. So if you might feel free to take one, and they have a little sign-up list to put your name down. Hey, you gotta get this girl under control. There ain't gonna be a baptism, all right? Man,
she's just helping out.
She thinks it's her day or something. That's all right. That's all right. All right. Any other announcements I might have missed, Linda? I think a fifth of my week this past week was just talking with Paul, so he's a little bit of a talker, but that was great. Paul does a good job. He's a good guy. So, any other announcements? Luann?
Newsletter comes out faster, so we need to get any stuff, any gossip that you want.
Newsletter. All right. So, get that to you pronto. All right.
Yes.
I forgot about that. Thank you. Anything else? It's also nice that we have our three amigos are back for our music is like together again, so it's good to have Sue and Susan and Nicole all back together. So let's turn to our responsive greeting this morning, which
We're going to use the Pew Bibles. Psalm 46, it's on page 885, pretty much the middle of the Bible. This is a beautiful hymn, and one that I actually frequently cite when I do hospital visits. It just reminds us, gives us a bigger perspective of life and of who God is, even in the times where things don't feel like they are going the way we think they should. Psalm 46. What we'll do is I will read the odd numbered verses, if you would please respond in the even numbered verses. Psalm 46. God is our refuge and strength, an ever-present help in trouble. Though its waters roar and foam and the mountains quake with their surging, God is within her. She will not fall. God will help her at break of day. Lord Almighty is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress.
Come and see the works of the Lord. Bless our nations, he has brought on the earth.
He makes wars cease to the ends of the earth. He breaks the bow and shatters the spear. He burns the shield with fire. God of Jacob is our fortress. We just read in verse 10, the psalmist calls us to be still before the Lord and know that he is God. And that is what our next hymn is about. Be still, my soul, 347. If you're able to, please stand and join us. 347, be still, my soul.
Thank you.
8 days after his birth, Mary and Joseph presented Jesus to God in the temple and was blessed by Simeon and Anna. In the Old Testament, Hannah dedicated her infant son Samuel to the Lord. And today, Jake and Andrea follow in their footsteps as they present their daughter Malia to the Lord. Baptism is an outward and visible sign of the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ. It is through this grace that we become partakers of his righteousness and heirs of his life eternal. Those receiving baptism come into the fellowship of Christ's holy church. Our Lord has expressly given to little children a place among the people of God, a holy privilege that must not be denied them. We remember the words of our Lord Jesus Christ, who said, "Let the children come to me and do not hinder them, for to such belong the kingdom of God." So this time I'd like to invite Andrea and Jake to come up. And they have some godparents as well. They would come up, and also Terry Taylor, the chair of our deacons as well. Are presenting their child for Christian baptism. Since baptism is a sacred ordinance, this is a sacred time in the life of Andrea and Jake and Malia and our church. It's very important for everyone to understand that we don't believe that baptism imparts regenerating, saving grace. That might, though. All right? She's blessing you. So what I want to say is the baptismal cup that Terry's holding today contains water, but this isn't magic water. This came from the tap downstairs, so you really know it's not magic water, okay? However, we do believe that God gave this holy ordinance as a sign and seal of the new covenant. Christian baptism signifies for this little girl God's gracious acceptance on the basis of prevenient grace. It is an acknowledgement of God's grace at work in the life of this child within the care of her mother and father and extended family and friends, and under the nurture of this community of faith. Her baptism points forward to the personal response Malia will need to make to that grace when she exercises conscious saving faith in Jesus Christ when she comes of age. So with that said, Jake and Andrea, do you desire for your child to be baptized today? In presenting the child for baptism, you are hereby doing four things. You are acknowledging that Malia is a gift from God, that ultimately Malia belongs to him, but that God has entrusted him to you as her parents. Acknowledging, as well, that it's your desire to see Malia come to a time in her life when she realizes, like every follower of Christ must do, that her sinful nature has separated her from her God. As evident right now, all right? That's not sinful. That's not sinful. And that on her own, she is unable to save herself, but that she needs a Savior and has a Savior in Jesus, who died on the cross to take away her sin and shame and to give her new life through him. Third, you're committing to raising Malia in the knowledge, fear, joy, and grace of Jesus Christ through your words and teachings, and also by maintaining your own vibrant personal relationship with Christ for her to emulate. Recognizing that God has given you his family to help you is your desire as well, lastly, to allow your church family to continue to come alongside of you as parents to teach, love, model, and pray for Malia. So parents, let me ask you these questions. First question, do you commit to do all that is possible to maintain a living and vibrant relationship with God so that you will be a continuous model for Malia and all your children?
Yes.
Do you commit to trust God to bring Malia and all your children into a personal and living relationship with him through Jesus Christ as Savior and the power of God's Spirit?
Yes.
Finally, you commit to do all that is possible to teach and nurture Malia in the things of the Lord by both personal instruction and by taking advantage of all the resources you have here at the church.
Yes.
And we have godparents, correct?
Yes.
Do you want to give a quick introduction we have up front with us?
We can.
Let's do it.
This is Godmommy Cassie, or Andy, Paul, or Uncle Paul, Uncle Dom, and Aunt Laura.
Excellent. And some of these are actual, like, relatives, right?
Yeah.
All right. Very good.
Aunt Laura.
Well, godparents do fill a special role in the life of a child.
Yep.
In accepting the role of godparents, you promise to participate in the life of this child, doing everything in your power and your strength to assist the parents, and especially in the spiritual nurture of this child. So let me ask you, do you, as Malia, promise to share responsibility with Jake and Andrea for this precious child, to pray for her, walk with her in the way of Christ, to help her take her place within the life and worship of Christ Church? If so, please answer with God's help, we will. What name have you given this child?
Malia Grace Kirk.
All right, Malia. Oh. Malia Grace Kirk, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we pray that you will take Malia into your loving care. Abundantly enrich her with your grace. Bring her safely through the perils of childhood. Deliver her from the temptations of youth. And lead her to a personal knowledge of Christ as her Savior. Help her to grow in wisdom and stature and favor with God and people. And to persevere in her faith. Uphold her parents with loving care, that with wise counsel and holy example, that they may be faithful to fulfill their responsibility both to Malia and to you. We pray this in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. I'm going to give you back, Grace. Hey, that's still a lot better than screaming and crying, isn't it? That's a lot better. Brothers and sisters of the household of God, as representatives of this church that welcomes Malia, you also have responsibility for this child. People of God, will you nurture one another in Christian faith and life and include Jake and Andrea and Malia into your care? Will you surround them with a community of love and forgiveness? Will you pray for them, extend to them Christian fellowship, and as much as it lies in you, to assist Jake and Andrea in raising Malia in the nurture and admonition of the Lord? If so, please say, with God's help, we will.
With God's help, we will.
Jake and Andrea, will you allow the fellowship of God's people, wherever you may be, if it's here or if you end up moving, going to some other church, to assist you in raising Malia in Christ, allowing us and them to be a witness to Christ's grace, a voice of God's Spirit, and a friend both to her and to yourselves? If so, please say, we will. All right, Malia, you are now part of the family of God that spans. Yeah, that's right. You heard your name. Part of the family of God that spans space and time, race and gender, generations and nations. We welcome you to the church that you may both give and receive of God's graces. Let us pray one more time. Father, we thank you for the gift of Malia. We pray for Malia, that she will understand that you alone can give life and meaning and purpose and direction, and that she will be on her knees before you with words of repentance and thanksgiving, and on her feet to serve you with deeds of love. This is our prayer in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. What a round of applause for Malia this evening. Baptism card, but thank you very much, everyone, and thank you, Malia. That was good times.
Thank you.
You guys were good.
Yeah.
I'm pretty sure it's not social distancing when the child puts her hand into your mouth, so I might be gone for a couple weeks, guys, all right? prayer now. In the back of your bulletin, you have your prayer request. Again, I remind you, if you're online, we'd love to have you leave a comment if you have a specific prayer, or you can message me specifically as well. I want to be praying, I know they're not our mission of the month, but the Salvation Army of Hillsdale, for a number of years now, Sean and Cassie Gray have been in charge down there, and this is their last Sunday. They got reassigned, they're moving to North Dakota, I believe, and we have a new leadership coming in, so we pray for Sean and Cassie as they begin a new stage of their life in North Dakota. We also want to be praying for our trustees, they meet today. But how else can we pray? What is on your hearts and minds that we can pray for? Yes, Stacia.
Prayers for the family of Mike Smith. His oldest son is one of Caleb's good friends. He passed away suddenly.
On Father's Day last week. Yeah, he graduated about your time?
He's a little older than me.
He's a little older.
Okay. He's a year older than I am.
Okay, so. That was a terrible thing, and absolutely crazy. What's her name? What's the thank you, Bernie.
The family of Ted Bernie. Yeah. Passed away last week. He was a long time Somerset Township fireman.
Thank you, Bernie.
My brother David is on his way.
Oh, my goodness.
So, max speed is 20 miles an hour.
Wow.
So, he can only fly for about 3 hours, and then he has to stop and refuel. So,
okay.
It's going to take him probably a couple of days, actually.
Okay.
Because he doesn't want to tax the plane.
Yeah.
With that long of a trip. But okay. It's been in Michigan forever.
All right.
And it's making its first flight to Texas.
All right.
So,
wow.
We just ask for prayers for his safety.
All right. Very good. Is he in flight now?
Yes.
All right.
This morning.
All right. We'll pray for David and the plane.
It's a long call.
Okay. Other prayer requests, Luann.
Pray for Mike Yoder and his wife.
Mike, it's good to have you here. And pray for us. Lisa.
For my friend Chris.
Yes.
He's on
the liver transplant list. And that's actually a prayer of praise as well, because last week when we prayed for him, we weren't sure he was even going to survive, and so you got news at the end of the service that, yep, great news. And also, Lily graduated yesterday, so congratulations to Lily as well. When does she report her basic training?
It's supposed to be October 6th.
Okay, so she has a little while yet.
She changes jobs, and that can
be coming up. Okay, all right. Congratulations to her, that's wonderful. Mike.
Yeah, prayer for Thanksgiving, Pastor, for our kids, and made home safe to California through the storm Friday night, through the disease and all the airports.
And they're home with you now?
Yep.
Oh, excellent. Amen. It's wonderful to have family together. Any other prayer requests? Let's join together in prayer, shall we? Our Father, it's our privilege and honor to come before you this morning, to gather together in your name to praise you. We thank you for this wonderful privilege we have. We thank you for those who given their lives that we might have the right to do that as American citizens here in 2020. We're thankful for people like Lily who's willing to serve on our behalf. We pray for her. We're thankful for her graduation. We pray for her protection and strength and as she goes forth to serve. Father, we think of Sean and Cassie Gray as this is their last Sunday at the Salvation Army. We pray for their move in their new season of life, especially with the young kids. We pray for them as well. It's just a special blessing they will, for them, because they've been just a tremendous blessing to our community for the past few years. And so we give you thanks. We pray for new leadership that comes to Salvation Army. They may continue to uphold the high standards of just serving and loving those in need in our county. We thank you for the young life of Addison. We thank you for Jim and Bridget Beach and their leadership and their love for teenagers here in our area. And we pray specifically for Bridget as she gets ready to have a baby here in a few weeks. We pray that everything will go healthy and well. Pray for our trustees, Karen and Donnie, Mike, Tim and Mike, as we get as they meet after the service. They do such a great job of keeping this place looking great and making sure money is where it should be. And so we just give thanks. And also for Jim, does such great work as our treasurer too. And we pray for wisdom for them as they come together to discuss whatever's on their docket this morning. Father, we continue to pray for families who are in a time and season of grief. You think of Jim and his family, and Sarah, and Hunter and Ann. We also think of Mike Smith's family, and we pray specifically for Amy Jo, and obviously this was not anywhere close on their radar, and just how life is, can change so suddenly like this. We pray for special blessing on them, and I hope, and I'm not sure, but if they're part of a church family, I pray that church family will come around them and just really support them, support her and the kids for the long haul, and if not, I pray that you lead her to a great church family if you do that. We pray also for the family of Ted Burdick, and we're thankful for his many years of service here in our community specifically. We pray for David as he flies to Texas. We pray that the plane would stay together, and if there's anything that pops up or anything that is alarming, that would be on the ground and not in the air, and we just pray for a safe many flights between here and Texas. Thankful that Mike could be with us today. We continue to pray for him and his foot and his health. Pray he had a season of good health here. Father, we also pray for Lisa's friend Chris. We're thankful that he is on the list and moving up for a liver transplant. And we pray that you would provide a donor for him and he would have a new season of life. We're thankful for the ability of families come together, especially this New Year's, July 4th weekend. We're thankful that Mike's kids could make it and had safe travels. And we pray for everyone who's going to be traveling in the next few days. Well, at this time, Father, we pray that you'd hear the prayers of your people as we take time to, in our heart of hearts, share with you any other prayer requests, words of confession, words of thanksgiving, words of praise. Hear now the prayers of your people. And Father, we also pray for Tyler Jones as he gets ready to join us here. In just 2 weeks, he'll be here, and he'll be here with us for a month, serving while I am gone, and I just pray this will be a special blessing for our church and for him as he has an opportunity to gain some experience as a seminarian in the pastorate, and so we pray for his preparation even now. Father, we continue with our service, especially when we come to the reading of your word. We look at the first chapter of Habakkuk. Father, there's a lot of good stuff there for us, but if your spirit doesn't open our hearts and ears and eyes to its truth, it's just it ain't gonna strike. And so I pray that your spirit would be alive and active in us, drawing us in, helping us to understand your word that was written 2,600 years ago, but is still relevant and is still powerful and active for us today. So would you do that, we pray. Thank you. In Jesus' name. We'll continue our worship now through the giving of our tithes and offerings. If I could have our ushers please come forward to receive this morning's offering.
Thank you.
Father, you have blessed us in more ways than we could ever count, ever realize, ever imagine. It is out of all that you have given to us that we give a portion back to you. And we ask that you would use it to glorify your great and amazing, majestic name in our world and help us to share the wonderful news of Jesus Christ and his gospel with our friends, our family, our neighbors, and even to those the other side of the world through the missionaries that we support. And Father, this morning we pray also as your Son Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. So this morning we begin a new sermon series. It's a short one. It's only 3 weeks as compared to 10 months. And it's on the book of Habakkuk. And so I encourage you to join with me. It'll be up here on the screen, but if you brought your Bibles or you want to read the Pew Bibles, it's page 1456, Habakkuk chapter 1, and also the first verse of chapter 2. The oracle that Habakkuk the prophet received. How long, O Lord, must I call for help, but you do not listen? Or cry out to you, violence, but you do not save? Why do you make me look at injustice? Why do you tolerate wrong? Destruction and violence are before me. There is strife and conflict abounds. Therefore, the law is paralyzed and justice never prevails. The wicked hem in the righteous so that justice is perverted. The Lord's answer. Look at the nations and watch and be utterly amazed. For I'm going to do something in your days that you would not believe, even if you were told. I am raising up the Babylonians, that ruthless and impetuous people, who sweep across the whole earth to seize dwelling places not their own. They are a feared and dreaded people. They are a law to themselves and promote their own honor. Their horses are swifter than leopards, fiercer than wolves at dusk. Their cavalry gallops headlong. Their horsemen come from afar. They fly like a vulture swooping to devour. They all come bent on violence. Their hordes advance like a desert wind and gather prisoners like sand. They deride kings and scoff at rulers. They laugh at all fortified cities. They build earthen ramps and capture them. Then they sweep past like the wind and go on. Guilty men whose own strength is their God. Here's Habakkuk's reply to the Lord's answer. O Lord, are you not from everlasting? My God, my Holy One, we will not die. O Lord, you have appointed them to execute judgment. O Rock, you have ordained them to punish. Your eyes are too pure to look on evil. You cannot tolerate wrong. Why then do you tolerate the treacherous? Why are you silent while the wicked swallow up those more righteous than themselves? You have made men like fish in the sea, like sea creatures that have no ruler. The wicked foe pulls all of them up with hooks. He catches them in his net. He gathers them up in his dragnet. And so he rejoices and is glad. Therefore, he sacrifices to his net and burns incense to his dragnet. For by his net he lives in luxury and enjoys the choicest food. Is he to keep on emptying his net, destroying nations without mercy? I will stand at my watch and station myself on the ramparts. I will look to see what he, that is God, will say to me and what answer I am to give to this complaint. God's word for us this morning. I want to take you back to a simpler time. December 31st, 2019. This is my house, a little New Year's party.
Get up.
Three.
Hey.
Part
seven, six, five, four, three, two, one.
Look at the optimism as we ushered into 2020. It was going to be a great year. We don't know anything. What a bunch of, we look like fools now in that picture. Not me, not in the picture, but those two right there. Let me remind you of all that's happened so far, 6 months into 2020. Oh. Remember, we had Nancy Pelosi ripping up Donald Trump's speech at the State of the Union. Donald Trump himself getting impeached. You had the debacle at the Iowa caucus where they couldn't figure out who won. Remember when we thought one of these two was going to be the Democratic presidential nominee at one point? Then, of course, I mean, doesn't that feel like a long time ago?
Yeah.
And then, of course, mid-March hit and we had COVID-19. And grocery stores looked like this. I can't, it's kind of shocking that that's a Scott's toilet paper roll still on one of the, there. Exactly, not for long. We were afraid to go out of our homes. Many still are. Schools were canceled. You couldn't go to movies or concerts, couldn't go to restaurants or bars anymore. And then of course you worried about this scene right here. This is a nursing home window. And you're really worried about getting to a nursing home because when it got into there, really bad things happened. Everything felt like it stopped, but of course numbers didn't stop, and we kept, every day it seemed like, looking and saying, well, how many cases are there in Hillsdale County now? How many deaths over in Branch County? What's happening in Lenawee? What's happening in Jackson? And that's just here. Of course, we look and see what's happening nationally and across the globe as well. And of course, along with that, of course, the economy tanked. Small businesses were forced to close. Many never will reopen. And unemployment, of course, skyrocketed. And just when you think 2020 couldn't get any worse, an officer put his knee on the neck of George Floyd for 8 minutes and 46 seconds, and George Floyd eventually died from this action, leading to nationwide protests that made it all the way to Hillsdale and Roger City, Michigan. And some of those protesters used it as an opportunity for violence. Others used it for an opportunity to, for personal gain, as rioting and looting became commonplace in some of America's greatest cities. Some places, city leaders instructed cops not to do anything, stand there, or worse, vacate and let it burn. And of course, over the past couple of weeks, this has been the biggest thing happening, is all the statues that have been being torn down, or they're trying to save the statues. And of course, on top of this, we have all the normal bad news as well. Natural disasters, sexual misconducts, COVID scams. I don't know if you remember, we had several U.S. representatives and senators who were caught dumping stock based on the early COVID news that they received so that they would keep their money and others wouldn't. And of course, oh yeah, there was a dam over in Midland, Michigan that broke, and homes and businesses, cities and towns were just devastated by this. And I bet a lot of you have no people or have friends like I do over in the Midland area. And the question that's appropriate to ask as we look at all these images is, where is God in all this? Does God care at all about what's happening? How can God allow this to even continue? These are the same questions, the same sentiments that the prophet Habakkuk uttered himself 2,600 years earlier. Now, of course, his was a different context than ours, but underneath there are the same realities. Listen again to his words, his complaint, verses 2 through 4, as you look at these images, and tell me if they don't apply today. How long, O Lord, must I call for help, but you don't listen? Or cry out to you violence, but you don't save? Why do you make me look at injustice? How do you tolerate wrong? Destruction and violence are before me. There is strife and conflict abounds. Therefore, the law is paralyzed, and justice never prevails. The wicked hem in the righteous so that justice is perverted. Now Habakkuk may not have experienced COVID and race riots, but this was no less a difficult time for him. The king and religious leaders of Judah, where he lived, had forsaken God and were worshiping idols and the false gods of the neighboring nations, even setting up altars to these false gods in the Lord's temple in Jerusalem. There was a culture of greed and immorality, deception, hatred, injustice, hypocrisy, and oppression. Innocent people were being killed, yet they got in the way of the rich and the powerful. The prophet looked around at the moral decay, the pain and the hurt, the injustice and the wickedness everywhere, and turned to God in anger and confusion and desperateness and said this, "How long, O Lord, must I call for help, but you do not listen, or cry out to you violence, but you do not save? Why do you make me look at injustice? Why do you tolerate wrong? God, I've been crying out to you for a long time. You haven't done anything. You're just sitting idly by and let it all go to hell, it feels like. And because you don't do anything, I have to sit around and watch injustice and wrongs and destruction and violence, strife and conflict. The law is paralyzed. It's a joke. There is no justice. The wicked do whatever they want to do while the righteous suffer. Are you kidding me, God? Where are you, God? Do something." While our circumstances were not the prophet's circumstances, his words, complaints, and questions resonate with us today, don't they? We know what he felt because we feel it too. We feel the anger and frustration and confusion. So we ask, well, what are we supposed to do with it? And already just four verses in, we have a truth that we can apply to our lives today. First, note the fact that Habakkuk's questions and complaints at God are actually recorded in the Bible for us to read. God is not afraid of the charges leveled at him. If he were, God would make sure that they didn't find its way into the Bible for us to read. Instead, here it is front and center in one of the 66 books of the Bible. And as we're going to see from God's response, God is not angry at the prophet for asking these questions. You know, one way God could have responded was, "How dare you? Who do you think you are, Habakkuk? I'm God. I'm the creator of everything. I will do as I please, and if you don't like it, I'll happily destroy you." He could have answered that way, but God didn't. In fact, God actually takes Habakkuk seriously and answers his questions. Friends, the first chapter of Habakkuk tells us that it's okay for us to bring our anger and confusion to God. We can be real with God when we don't understand what's happening to us and around us, why we're going through something. God allows us to wrestle with him, as it were. Now, this is hard for some religious folks to do. We think that when we go through hard times, we just got to grit and bear. That's the Christian thing to do. We know we got to say something like, "I don't understand, but God's in control. God has a plan," and we merrily go on our way, even though that's exactly what we feel the opposite inside. When we do that, we're not being real with God. We have some real issues, and we're not at peace about it. And here we see God invite us to dialogue with him, to express our doubt and grief and anger and confusion to him directly. Friends, remember, God already knows what you're thinking and feeling. He's not going to be taken aback by your emotions. God wears big boy pants. He can handle it. Now, others have the exact opposite problem. While they too feel the anger and confusion, they don't bring it to God either, not because they think it's wrong or unrighteous or something, but because they don't want to bother God. God's so busy running the world. Why would he care for my concern? Or because they think, I can get through this myself. Whatever problems I've got, they're my problems. I don't want to burden God with it. I'll figure it out. I'll take care of it. To those people, Habakkuk is a reminder that God does want to hear from you. God is concerned about you specifically, not just the world. Yes, God is running the whole world, but it's not hard for an omnipotent being to do that. That's what it means to be. God's all-powerful. He has time for you and wants you to turn to him for help. God is there waiting, and God will answer you, just like he answered Habakkuk. And to that answer, we now turn in verses 5 through 6. Here's how God answers Habakkuk's cry for how long, O Lord. God says, "Look at the nations and watch. Be utterly amazed. For I'm going to do something in your days that you would not believe even if you were told. I am raising up the Babylonians, that ruthless and impetuous people who sweep across the whole earth to seize dwelling places not their own." Habakkuk cries out for God to do something about the injustice and the violence in Judah. And God answers him by saying he's at work. He's got a plan. He is going to be doing something. And it's going to astound you. You won't even believe it, Habakkuk. God is raising up the Babylonians to invade Judah. Babylon will serve as an instrument of divine judgment and justice against his own people in Judah. Babylon was an up-and-coming nation here in the beginning of the 6th century BC. They had recently conquered the great empire of Syria, who had ruled the ancient Near East for hundreds of years. And Babylon was not like any other nation at that point. They were just an unstoppable war machine that conquered and destroyed at ease. They had no match, and these tiny nations like Judah had no hope against them. Listen to how God describes Babylon in our passage today. He says that they are a ruthless and impetuous people, feared and dreaded. They are a law unto themselves, meaning that they don't care about universal basic human rights. The only law that matters to them is the law of power and strength, and since they got it, they'll do what they want. No one can say anything different. They promote their own honor, meaning that they are prideful and arrogant. All that matters to them is their own glory. Their military might had no equal. Their horses were swifter than leopards, fiercer than wolves, flying in like a vulture to devour. They were bent on violence, which meant that they wanted violence. They wanted to kill. It wasn't a last option after diplomacy failed. No, it was their first and primary option. They liked it. They wanted to do it. They were bent on violence. They knew that they were so unmatched in the world around them. That is, they mocked and scoffed and laughed at other kings and their security apparatuses. Ultimately, God says that their strength was their God. It was what they worshipped and honored and valued because it was their military strength that brought them all the power and luxury they wanted. Needless to say, God was correct when he answered Habakkuk's prayer that the prophet would be utterly amazed and wouldn't believe what God was about to do. By raising up Babylon as his divine instrument of judgment and punishment and justice against his people, Judah. Listen to Habakkuk's response on receiving this news from God. Verses 12 to 13, Habakkuk says, "O Lord, are you not from everlasting? My God, my Holy One, we will not die. O Lord, you have appointed them to execute judgment. O Rock, you have ordained them to punish. Your eyes are too pure to look on evil. You cannot tolerate wrong. Why then do you tolerate the treacherous? Why are you silent while the wicked swallow up those more righteous than themselves?" Let me translate. This is Habakkuk saying, "Wait, what, God? Are you serious? God, you're holy and infinite. How in the world can you do this? How in the world can you appoint and ordain Babylon to punish your people? They're worse than us. Much worse. God, you are too pure to allow this to happen. How can you tolerate this? How can you sit back and allow this?" The prophet goes on to talk about how easy it is for Babylon to advance and destroy across the earth. It's like shooting fish in a barrel, or in their case, in dragnets. Finally, Habakkuk asked God in verse 17 if he's just going to let Babylon continue destroying nations without mercy. Are you going to do something? Are you going to step in, God? Are you going to allow this? Friend, this is a reminder to us that God always answers the prayers of his children, but that sometimes we might not like the answer. Sometimes the answer makes no sense from our vantage point. It made absolutely no sense to the prophet that Judah should be punished for its sins by a nation whose sins were more atrocious than theirs. And what God's answer really does to Habakkuk is it challenges the prophet's very understanding of who God is and what God is like. Notice back in verse 12, Habakkuk says, "O Lord, are you not from everlasting? My God, my Holy One." And then in verse 13, "Your eyes are too pure to look on evil. You cannot tolerate wrong." What he's saying there is, God, your actions don't match with how I understand who you are. You don't match up with how I think you should act. And this causes the prophet to experience an existential crisis of his faith. I'm guessing that many, if not all of you, have been through something like this in your lives. You've gone through some terrible, unexpected hardship. Perhaps it was a sudden loss of a loved one, a terrible fire, maybe an injustice directed at you uncaused. And you wonder, how could God let this happen? Why you and not some meth head down the street? Why you and not some thief who's breaking into barns and sheds and lake houses? Shouldn't God bring disaster on them and not you? You who follow God, who go to church, who try to live a good life and be a good citizen and a good family member. Have you ever felt, or you are feeling that way? You can see from our text today that this is not an uncommon response. Even the Lord's own prophet of God, responded that way. So how much less us? Again, I think the fact that this response is recorded in Scripture is God's way of saying, I get it. I get your response to this. It isn't crazy to react this way. It's actually a very real and human way to respond. But while that is a natural way to react, the question is, well, what do we do next? Do we stay stuck in that reaction? Do we stay angry at God for how he answered our prayers? Do we turn our backs on God and question his love for us, maybe question his own existence? Well, take a look at what Habakkuk does next. If the prophet's responses and reactions mirror our natural responses and reactions to God, then perhaps what Habakkuk does next, his next steps, maybe they are to serve as a model for us, what we are to do next as well, in our confusion and in our anger. Let's read what he does, chapter 2, verse 1. Habakkuk says, I will stand at my watch and station myself on the ramparts. I will look to see what he will say to me and what answer I am to give to this complaint. Habakkuk responds to his confusion and shock at God's answer with two things: patience and perspective. Patience and perspective. The prophet realizes that how God answered him was so disorienting and challenging to him that what he needs most right now is patience and perspective. I will stand at my watch. I will look to see what he, God, will say to me. Friends, that's patience. That's the prophet saying that he needs to take some time to consider what's going on here. He needs time to wait on the Lord and see what God's going to do next, how God will answer his second cry. And this is sound wisdom. When we are overwhelmed with our circumstances, when we are unable to process and understand where God is in all of this, one of the best things we can do is simply wait on the Lord to exercise patience, which of course isn't an easy thing to do. It's not a natural thing to be patient. Patience is really a decision of the will. I love how one theologian put it. Patience is laying down the burden of assumed omniscience. Patience is laying down the burden of assumed omniscience, meaning that it is setting aside that desire, that want to know all the reasons why something happened, why we're going through what we're going through. We have a natural inclination to not only want to know why, but also we are inclined to think we know how things should have gone, how things should go. Patience is a decision of the will to lay that burden down, to say to God, I actually don't know how everything should go. I don't actually know everything. Nor do I know all that you have planned, God. It's realizing the truth of Isaiah 55, 8 through 9, where the prophet says, God says, for my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, declares the Lord. As the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. Exercising patience is an act of humility. It is pride that believes we know how things should go and ought to go. But besides patience, the other thing the prophet does is get perspective. Notice where Habakkuk practices his patience. Where he stands his watch is on the ramparts. Now, what is a rampart? A rampart is a defensive wall of a city that has a broad top that you can walk around the city on top of the wall. Other translations use the word tower rather than rampart. The point being that Habakkuk is going up. He's going to a high place where he can get a better view of what is or could be happening on the horizon to see what is ahead. Spiritually speaking, this is exactly what we need in our time of confusion and anguish. We need to gain perspective and see a bigger picture. Paul gives us an example of this in Romans 8:18. He writes, "I consider that our present sufferings are not worth comparing with the glory that will be revealed in us." Now, Paul was suffering tremendously. And that word here, consider, is a Greek word that means to add up. So here's Paul adding up all the things going on in his life. He had multiple attempts on his life, organized attempts, plans to assassinate him. He had been stoned and left for dead once. He had been betrayed and forsaken by close Christian ministry partners. He was dealing with physical ailments, including an eye problem. He had been falsely imprisoned, flogged, beaten with rods. He'd almost died sailing, was left on the open sea for a night and a day. He had known hunger and thirst and even nakedness. And on top of that, he had a secular government and a religion against him, hampering his very work and ministry daily, trying to undo the good that he'd done, starting churches all across the region. Paul had problems. Paul could have, and perhaps did, cry out the same words as Habakkuk cried out here in Habakkuk 1. How long, O Lord? But like Habakkuk, Paul gets some perspective. Paul views things from a higher vantage point, from an eternal vantage point. He says, I consider. I'm adding up that our present sufferings are not worth comparing with the glory that will be revealed in us. What Paul is doing here is he is climbing the ramparts. He is ascending the tower to get a better view of his circumstances. What Paul is saying here is that, yes, I have some big problems. Yes, I have experienced some unjust and terrible things. But when I compare all that to the glory that awaits me, the glory that will be revealed in me, well, then my present sufferings are actually quite small. They're a very small comparison because as a Christian, all of my greatest and most ultimate problems have already been solved in Jesus Christ. The only sickness that can really destroy me for good, which is sin, has been healed through Jesus. The only debt that can really destroy me for good, the debt of my sin, has been paid by Jesus. The only real enemy that can destroy me for good, sin, death, and Satan, they have been defeated at the cross and the empty tomb by Jesus. Friends, when we struggle with not understanding what God is doing around us and in us, or why something has happened to us that we don't deserve, we need to climb our spiritual ramparts, our spiritual towers, to gain a better perspective. It's amazing when you are high up how small things look below. May we, like Habakkuk, seek patience and perspective in our times of confusion and anguish. Next week, we'll continue in Habakkuk chapter 2 to hear God's answer to the prophet's cry of how in the world God could use Babylon, a nation worse than Judah, to punish Judah for its sins. Let's close in prayer. Heavenly Father, I don't know who needs to hear this today. You do. Of course, we all need to hear it, but sometimes we go through some things, or we're about to go through some things, or we look back at things we went through, and it doesn't make any sense to us. We're thankful for the book of Habakkuk. It reminds us that you know what's going in us. You know our thoughts and our emotions. You're not taken back by them. And as we see here, you tell us to cry these out to you. And you can handle them, to be real with you. Father, we confess that there are times where we think we know what should be done. We think we know what should have been done. And that's spiritual pride, Father. I pray that you would give us patience and humility to trust you. We pray for perspective, Father. And we go through these times, and we might turn to your word. We might turn to your church. We might turn to good Christian friends to be reminded of the greater, bigger picture. Because, Father, we know that whatever, how big our problems look now, 10,000, 100,000 years, when we are with you, they're going to be very, very, very small in comparison. That doesn't erase the fact how we feel today, though. So, Father, I pray for whoever is hurting and struggling today, that you would help them comfort them, strengthen them, and most of all, help them to be patient and help them to have a bigger perspective. We pray this in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Our final hymn this morning is in your bulletin. It's an insert. It's a new hymn. It's called Afflicted Saint to Christ Draw Near, which is basically what we've been talking about today. Patient perspective is all about drawing near to Christ in our times of confusion. But I encourage you to stand up and let us sing Afflicted Saint to Christ Draw Near. Outside and do it there, all right? Hear now the benediction. But the God of all grace, who has called you into his eternal glory by Jesus Christ, after you have suffered a little while, may he make you perfect, establish you, strengthen and settle you. To him be glory and dominion forever and ever. Go in his power and grace today. Amen.
Yeah.